Welcome back, movie fans, to a completely on-time episode of Hollow Victories, where winning is at least a little bit better than the Razzies. I'm Matt Presents, and I am joined, as always, by my macho co-host.
Hello, I'm 80s Mike. Hey, Matt, have you heard this new sound? It's going to define the generation, Matt. Matt, have you seen any 80s movies? What 80s movies have you seen, Matt?
I think I saw this movie from the 80s, Guardians of the Galaxy?
Oh my gosh, that's my favorite 80s movie currently. Big stuff is happening.
I just want to say, we've had late episodes before. This is the first time it's Michael's fault. Michael decided his brother's wedding was more important than talking about disco musicals from the 80s.
I'll make up for this by skipping any future family weddings.
So you better.
Can get, like, multiple episodes out a single month, you know? I honest to God, if we would have just started this one earlier in the month, it would have been on time. It's my bad for not, like, the end of the month absolutely got busy. I knew it was gonna get busy, and I just didn't think about Hollow Victories. I should have.
Some warning would be nice, but also I have gotten pretty bad about doing this later in the month than usual. Like, every month I'm like, we can put it off another week.
The thing is, though, you have been good. Like, even if it is a little late, you haven't missed a month for how many years have we been doing this?
3.
And I know, like, a monthly podcast isn't as hard to manage as, like, a weekly one or bi-weekly one, but it is still, like, to be able to do it without missing a month, I think, is, like, a hard task. I mean, I can't even fucking... Chaos Drive has been a show for 8 months, and there's 2 episodes. Technically only 1, because we don't really count the first one as the official show.
Yeah, the second one came out, and I commented. I'm like, oh, finally, a second episode, and then you guys are like, this is the first episode, and I'm like, oh, never mind, I guess.
Because the first one, like, was just me and Chris. It was like a test pilot. That show will continue to come out, but it's probably gonna maintain this pace, and I think we're all okay with that. I don't want it to be another 6 month wait, but every, like, 2 to 3 months, probably.
Today on Hollow Victories, we have a matchup of disco musicals from the year 1980. But more than that, these two films inspired the existence of the infamous Golden Raspberry Awards.
I didn't know
that. So I think probably between these films, we'll stop and we'll talk a little bit about the Razzies. And our thoughts on it. I certainly have opinions. But first, I think we better get into the first movie. It's Xanadu versus Can't Stop the Music. And Michael, if you would like to introduce the film Xanadu, I think that would be lovely.
Xanadu, released August 8th, 1980, directed by Robert Greenwald, tells the story of an artist who wants to make his own passion projects, but he's stuck working for a company basically painting giant versions of albums for promotional reasons, I guess. It's not fulfilling work for him, but one day he runs into a woman who, you know, really catches his eye, and then she shows up on one of the albums he has to paint. So now, clearly, this is the direction his life has to go in, is hunting down this woman. Like, that's destiny. I encourage all people to do the same. If you see a woman on an album cover that you're attracted to, please try to hunt them down and find out their information.
Well, okay. If you get if a woman randomly comes up to you and kisses you, and then that same day you see her on an album cover,
track
her down.
Yeah, like I'm saying, yeah, track them down. Yeah, so she is one of the daughters of Zeus, and she, like, there's this painting on this there's like this big painting on this building that they all kind of come out of and mess around on Earth a bit. They're not supposed to stay, though. They're not supposed to stick around, but she falls in love with this artist guy. So,
well, she's a muse.
Yeah.
You had established that. She's a muse from the ancient Greek mythology.
And there's also this plot where, what's his name? Gene Kelly has a character, you know, pretty big musical legend with Singing in the Rain. They even kind of, it almost seems like reminiscent of that too, since he's playing like an older person in this movie, like kind of looking back at the glory days. He's trying to open up this club, And that becomes a big part of the movie, too, where they're trying to open this club. Meanwhile, our main character is trying to, you know, do what he's passionate about, but also he's interested in this girl, and it's a love story, and, you know, it's a pretty generic story, but the execution is definitely interesting. Matt, what did you think of Xanadu?
Oh, man, Xanadu is a lot of fun. Here's the thing, sometimes I'll call, like, a movie or whatever lame, and usually I mean that it's, like, kind of boring. This movie is, like, hilariously lame. Like, it's funny how lame this movie is. Like, if someone asked me to write, like, a parody of, like, a super lame musical, this would be about the best you could do with that.
Yeah. It also, like, it's an hour and 30 minutes, which is appropriate for a story like this. Like, I'm glad it really doesn't drag on too much, and it gets fucking ridiculous in some areas. I still can't. The weirdest scene in the movie is the guy going to buy a suit. Like, they make a musical number around that. That is just, I remember when I was watching with you, like, I was kind of like, okay, like, all of the musical sequences were bizarre, you know, and I mean, that is something that I enjoy about it, is how bizarre it is. That one was pure fucking nonsense, but I also kind of appreciate the movie for that. And I do think there's, like, a couple of things, like, that are, like, genuinely interesting about it. Like, again, I think surrounding Gene Kelly's character, there's a lot of, like, reminiscing on the past, and I think it works considering who Gene Kelly is. And I kind of like the idea of them, like, merging, like, you know, the style of, like, the musicals he was in and, like, the modern stuff, like, you know, the 80s stuff that our, you know, our main guy is trying, like, him and Olivia Newton-John are, like, focused on. I do think the combination is interesting at points. I will give this movie some credit. I think most of it is just dumb fun, but I kind of appreciate things about it, too.
Yeah. This is a movie that could only have come out in the year 1980. 81, it would have been dated, right? Because it does have, like, some 80s style, like, especially that scene you were talking about at, like, the, where he goes to get a suit.
Yeah.
There's a lot of, like, 80s fashion in that. And there's the scene where, like, they're envisioning, like, what would go on in their little club, and Gene Kelly, he's picturing this big band, but Glenn Beck, he's imagining, like, oh, it's this 80s rock band.
Oh, it's Michael Beck.
Michael Beck, fuck. Okay, my mistake. As it's granted, it's all stuff that was, like, getting popular by the end of the 70s, but it's, like, stuff that would come to define the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, most of this movie is, like, firmly planted in the 70s. It's a lot of disco music.
Mm-hmm.
Olivia Newton-John is there, and she stopped being a big star after this.
Uh-huh. I only ever knew her from Grease, but obviously Grease is a huge one.
Yeah, no, she was, like, kind of known in the 70s. By the 80s, not so much. Even Gene Kelly being in this, like, here's the thing, in the 70s, there were a bunch of throwback musicals to the musicals of the 50s,
right?
Like Singing in the Rain. But those were all throwbacks to the musicals of the 30s. So it's just this weird repeating cycle where, like, it's like the 70s were referencing the 50s and the 50s were referencing the 30s.
For a long time, we were doing the 80s, like, not too long ago.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, we've kind of gotten into the 90s and the 2000s by now.
Yeah. It is interesting to see, like, 2000s nostalgia make it in now.
But, the whole Gene Kelly throwback to the old school musicals, that's a very 70s thing, even though this came out in 1980. Right. And, I mean, like, I've said this before, but, like, when we break down decades, usually there's, like, a year or so of, like, transition period. I feel like the 80s didn't really start till, like, 81, 82. I feel like the 90s didn't start till, like, Nirvana and Jurassic Park had come out. I feel like the 2000s hadn't started until 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
No, so I got you. This is a movie that has 1 foot in the 70s and 1 foot in the 80s, and thus could only have come out in 1980.
You've definitely got a better eye for like stuff like that, like like all the history and whatnot, but
sure. But I mean, it's a fun movie. It's a really fun movie.
Right. It is. Like, honest to God, start to finish, I was enjoying myself with it. I get why it's on Hall of Victories. There's not, like, this isn't me coming out and saying, oh, like, this is, like, a 10 out of 10. I think I gave it a 4, because it is really dumb. But it's, like, it's a loving 4 out of... honest to God, when something gets a 4, a 4 is... because a 5 can mean it's just, like, perfectly average. Like, it's boring. A 4 can mean it's bad but entertaining, because if it wasn't entertaining, it'd be like looking at a 3 or 2 or a 1, you know? Like, I feel like a 4 is, in a way, it's like sometimes better than a 5 or a 6, you know? If that makes any sense.
Sure.
And yeah, this is one of those movies. I could show this to someone and have a good time watching it again. And again, it being short helps too, because I think movies like this are fun to watch. I don't need them to hit the 2 hour mark. I don't need them to hit the 3 hour mark, you know? And yeah, I don't honestly know how much I have to say about either of these, but I do think it's I think we can get a conversation out of it, but my opinions on them are kind of broad, you know? Like, it's just like, yeah, that was fun.
Yeah. No, I had a good time with this one. I especially like almost all of the musical numbers are fun. Even, like, I don't think this is, like, the greatest music ever. I'm not gonna be listening to most of these songs on my own time, but, like...
Right.
They come up with some fun musical numbers. The one I really want to talk about is when it just becomes animated out of nowhere.
I loved that.
Don Bluth animation, by the way. Don Bluth animated this. And I gotta say, when I watched this in, like, high school... and that happened, I was, like, kind of laughing at it. I'm like, ah, they suddenly animated out of nowhere. That's so wacky. That's so ridiculous. But, like, on rewatch, I'm like, no, that's kind of, like, a really interesting, like, aesthetic choice. You know? I'm kind of with it. I wish more musicals would just have, like, an animated sequence.
It kind of, like, makes me think of something I would see, like, I don't know, something more modern. Like I could see, like, a YouTuber making a movie like that, where that just happens in the middle of it, you know? Like,
sure. I mean...
not, like, the fucking we love... YouTuber movies. I'm talking about, like, an actual filmmaker on YouTube.
We love mixed media nowadays. Yeah, so stuff like Shrek 2, I'm sorry, Shrek Retold, The People's Joker, even Barbara Westchester.
Yeah, not everyone was lucky enough to see Shrek 2 Retold yet, Matt.
We're in Shrek 2 Retold. Shout out to us.
Shout out to us.
When that comes out. I think. Okay, yeah, no, that's not too far off. Check out Shrek 2 Retold when it comes out. We are in, like, a single frame.
We're in it for almost a whole second.
almost a whole second.
I edited the shot. I think we were 3 frames off of it being a second. But, you know, I thought it was really cool. And obviously, like, Don Bluth is an animation legend. And, I mean, his stuff, even when his movies are kind of shit, which there's been a bad Don Bluth movie. They could probably be covered on the show. But it always looks wonderful. His art style is, like, Probably one of the better ones, honestly. It looks amazing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, especially, like, in 1980, he was, like, one of the best guys who could have gotten to do this random animated sequence in the middle of the film.
Yeah. Definitely inspired a lot of, like, web animators. Like, Harry Partridge, you'll see a lot of, like, the Don Bluth style in his work. Yeah, that was a really neat scene. I'm glad you brought it up, because I honestly forgot about that. And now that you bring it up, I'm like, how did I forget about that? I think it's just because it's a longer gap than usual. We did watch this movie like 2 weeks ago.
Not a full 2 weeks ago, but it has been like a week and a half.
Yeah.
I will say I don't know... like, the story itself is kind of thin, and the musical numbers don't add a whole lot. But I almost feel like, oh, you're here for the musical numbers, right?
Right. They don't add a lot to the story, but the story is nothing without them.
Yeah.
Like, you can't, the movie doesn't work on the story alone. The movie, if you didn't have those, the movie, like, plot would be really boring. In fact, I mean, yeah. Both of these movies would be incredibly fucking boring without the musical numbers, because they're both very generic stories. I mean, like, the most basic, like, nobody becomes popular stories.
Yeah, but you say that, but also, like, this movie has that whole thing about, like, Olivia Newton-John being one of the muses. And there's the scene where, like, Michael Beck, like, Roadrunner logics himself into heaven?
Yeah.
And talks with Zeus and Hera and convinces them to let Olivia Newton-John come back to Earth?
That's a great point. And it kind of completely shuts down what I was just arguing, but that isn't most of the movie. That is,
That's like, it's such a small part of the movie that you're like, what the fuck is this? Where did this come from?
Right. He does literally do the fucking Wile E. Coyote thing. Like, someone could have done, like, I imagine someone witnessed that and tried doing it themselves right after and, like, it basically died.
Yeah, someone sees him roller skate into this painting and they're just like, I gotta try that, and they like run smack into the wall like fucking Troy in Community.
Abed talked him out of it, I remember.
Yes. Gee whiz. Do we want to talk about this cast?
Yeah. I mean, we kind of already talked about, like, I think two of the most notable people in it, Olivia Newton-John and Gene Kelly. We could definitely talk about them more. Like, we didn't really talk about their performance yet.
Sure. Olivia Newton-John plays Kira. She has the Death Note in this movie.
Yes.
Very important plot point. She got hired because she was in Greece, right?
Probably. I mean, why wouldn't that, like, result in it, the careers of the people in Greece after that movie were quite interesting. How has John Travolta not shown up in one of these yet?
Oh, surely we've seen John Travolta in something, right?
I don't remember seeing him yet.
I'm
looking up his filmography.
I don't think we have.
Like, he could be the fucking king one day.
Yeah, that's insane that we haven't covered a John Travolta movie.
I'm looking up his filmography. I want to see if I'm right about that, because maybe he even did a voice in something.
Yeah, we haven't covered a John Travolta movie yet. That's wild.
Face Off.
I need to find something to pair up with Battlefield Earth. Face Off, I kind of enjoy. Face Off, I don't know, it's cheesy as hell, but I kind of love it in spite of that.
I haven't seen it, and I'd love to see it, is the thing. I've basically seen it. Like, I've seen so much from that movie, I've seen so many reviews of that movie, I just never actually sat down and watched it start to finish.
I mean, we could just straight up do, like, Battlefield Earth versus Gotti.
Gotti would definitely be one, you know? That would just be the John Travolta pair up. Unless there's, like, something else, like, that would be, like, really fitting for Battlefield Earth. Like, it's, something that's just, like, another movie in that same genre, and then Gotti could be paired of something else. Like, they definitely could be paired of different movies. But I'm not against the just doing it based off John Travolta. I mean, we did that for Schneider. Why not Travolta?
Well, I mean, but Gotti is, like, the greatest movie ever made. It would be unfair to show it on Hollow Victories.
Right, right. Of course. Olivia Newton-John, I mean, she fits the role fine. For what the movie is, I've got no problem with it. The performance, at least.
Yeah, I don't know. She's fun enough. Gene Kelly in his final, like, acting performance. I think he's in some documentaries after this.
No, I think you're right. I remember we were looking at it when we were watching this.
Yeah, this is his final role as an actor.
It's kind of a fitting final role for him, honestly, because, again, it does seem so reminiscent of, like, his career.
I mean, yeah, but at the same time, it was kind of panned when it came out. This is one that's, like, had a bit of a reevaluation over the years. I mean, it was part of that, like, Criterion channel. They did, like, a programming block based around the Razzies of, like, movies that were Razzie-nominated but have kind of been, like, reclaimed as like, good movies. And, like, I kind of get why someone would try to reclaim this, because, like, I also absolutely get why it was panned in 1980. It feels super out of date for 1980. But at the same time, I could see someone coming back to it years later, like, out of the context in which it was released and going, like, hey, this is actually kind of a fun movie.
Yeah. Yeah, I can absolutely see why it would be poorly received, and honest to God, if I was, like, a critic on Rotten Tomatoes, you know, it's not like my score would be a rotten one, like, with how I rated it, it would be a 40%, like, that wouldn't be a positive review. But I think that it's kind of like, can you acknowledge that a movie isn't very good but still worth watching, you know? Because I think that that's a big thing that, especially today, that people are, like, open to. Is reevaluating movies like this, because a lot of the time it's like, I don't know, like, I think of, I watched that Dolomite movie about them making the movie, that they're famous for. I never actually saw that movie, but that movie kind of, like, preaches just the idea of, like, knowing your audience, you know, like, knowing that this isn't going to be something that everyone enjoys, knowing that it's silly, but knowing that there is people who are going to love it, you know?
See, I haven't seen... It's like, My Name Is Dolomite with Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, I liked it.
I haven't seen that one, but I have seen the original Dolomite. I kind of love Rudy Ray Moore's movies.
Yeah, like, the movie, like, My Name Is Dolomite is slow at the start, but when they actually get into them making the movie, I think they actually pulled it off better than The Disaster Artist did. Disaster Artist was a disappointment for me. Not bad, but could have been, like, could have been a 10 with the right people.
It's such a good book, and then the movie is just like a Seth Rogen, James Franco comedy. Even I'm like,
it feels like they're kind of just
fine.
Saying, hey, we know what people find funny about this movie. There's the story is good enough to where it's not bad, but it's like, oh man, give this to someone. I'm not saying Tim Burton should make it, but like Tim Burton with Ed Wood definitely. Like, there was an angle outside of, haha, people think this movie's funny. Let's acknowledge what people think is funny about this movie. No, they wrote, it kind of feels like the Disaster Artist. Like, the number one thing that they did right was just that James Franco did a really solid impression. Not the biggest James Franco fan, but he did do a good job with that, I'll say.
Yeah. I mean, didn't he, like, leading into the Oscar season, he kind of got canceled and then, like, didn't get an Oscar nomination for that.
I don't know if he would have gotten...
Despite the fact that I feel like he deserved at least a nomination. Because he won the Golden Globe! I remember that because Tommy Wiseau was on stage and, like, tried to take the microphone from James Franco. And he was like, nah.
I think it's like kind of like Robbie Malek in Bohemian Rhapsody, where, like, great performance, not an amazing movie.
I mean, I like Disaster Artist better than Bohemian Rhapsody.
For fucking sure. I'm just saying, like, the performance is, like, the only thing carrying it.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. I get you.
Like, I had no qualms with Rami Malek winning Best Actor that year. I think any other award Bohemian Rhapsody won was bullshit. Didn't it win fucking editing that year?
It won fucking editing that year.
Despite being possibly the worst edited movie released that year. Like, I'm sure there's some kid who made something in Windows Movie Maker that was edited better than that.
Yeah, no, it was not especially good editing.
No.
Fucking Michael Beck.
Whatever.
What a... Michael Beck is, like, a strange actor, because he was like, the star of The Warriors,
mm-hmm.
which is a great movie, And then you look at the rest of his filmography, and it's all this, like, super cheesy, like, low-budget stuff. I mean, obviously he was in Xanadu, he was in Mega Force, he was in Battle Truck, and I'm just like, man, this dude has had, like, a hilarious career. Except The Warriors, which is, like, weirdly actually good.
Sometimes it's just misdirection, you know? Sometimes it's a bad manager, sometimes it's, sometimes it's also just a fluke. Sometimes someone, just, like, the right person for one role and one role alone.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's sometimes you just find that writer, director, casting agent who puts the right person in the right role.
Yeah.
And, like, otherwise their career is not very good. Like, I like, Sandler is good when you put him in the right role.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Although Sandler, I'll say, I can at least, like, point to, like, a handful of things that he did really well in.
Yeah, I mean, sure. But there are other actors I could point to that, like, I generally don't like, but then I'm like, oh, but, like, in this movie, they did really good. That was a good role for them.
Right.
In the first issue of Keep Movies Weird, I wrote about the movie Retroactive, where I think Jim Belushi is actually pretty good.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one yet, but I remember your article on it. But yeah, like, I don't know, Michael Becky, I can't really criticize the performance. It's exactly what I expect out of this. It's kind of like Olivia Newton-John. They're just like, I don't know, like, I kind of feel like Gene Kelly's the heart of this movie while those two are just doing, they're working with what they got, you know? So they're not especially interested in characters, but when push comes to shove and we're doing the, you know, the fun dance scenes or some of the crazy shit, like him jumping into the wall, like, you know, it's fine. They are part of what makes the movie entertaining.
I mean, there are, like, barely other characters besides those. There's, like, his co-workers.
His boss.
And otherwise, yeah.
It's not a movie with, like, a especially large number of interesting characters. I'd argue that Can't Stop the Music doesn't have a large list of interesting characters either, but it does have more characters that you can point at, mainly just because the village people, they're all in there and they each have, like, their own unique costume and their own introduction into the story, so they're at an advantage with that. Where this one, you kind of get the three characters that matter right off the bat, and we just focus on them. Everyone else is kind of just there to fill the scene in, I guess. You know, you want to have a lot of dancers, you want to have a lot of people in these scenes.
Yeah. One of the muses is Sandahl Bergman, for famous playing the villain in Red Sonja.
Hey, there you go.
And she's the love interest in Conan the Barbarian. She's in The Ice Cream Man with Clint Howard.
Hey.
I don't know, Clint Howard back. She's had an interesting career. She was in All That Jazz, which is, like, legit one of my favorite movies.
You keep naming stuff I haven't seen. I gotta watch more fucking movies. I feel like I see so much more now because of you, but there's only so much time in the world. Like, yeah. your soul is, like, completely dedicated to movies, where I'm, like, splitting it down with, like, different mediums.
Yeah, I mean, you play plenty of video games. You watch more TV than I do.
Yeah. Right now, my focus is movies that are based on TV shows, too. So that's, like, most of the movies I'm watching right now. Anyways, but yeah, like, I don't know. I think I've said everything I have to say about this. Do you have anything else to add?
I do want to talk briefly about the film's director, Robert Greenwald.
Okay.
Because something I learned about him very, very recently. This was not his first movie, but it was his first, like, big studio movie, right? And it kind of flopped, and he kind of struggled to find his footing after this. But then in the 2000s, he got, like, fairly popular for making these straight-to-video, anti-Bush, anti-conservative documentaries. He was, like, quite literally, bargain bin Michael Moore in the 2000s.
I'm looking at his, like, when you brought him up, I, like, looked at what he did, and he has, like, a big list of feature-length documentaries. Yeah, like, 2003 to 2019.
Yeah.
He's got a couple on the Iraq War.
He He very much rode the Michael Moore coattails through the 2000s, which is wild to me. Because I was just, like, listening to some people talk about one of his films, and they're like, oh yeah, this guy, he apparently directed Xanadu, and I'm like, wait, the director of Xanadu was, like, a political documentarian in the 2000s?
Right.
So that's just like an interesting fact about this director.
Yeah, no.
He made liberal documentaries in the 2000s.
Do you want to talk about the Razzies before or after Can't Stop the Music?
Let's talk about the Razzies, because, of course, the impetus for this matchup is that these two films have been credited by Razzies founder John Wilson as the two movies that inspired the Razzies, that made the Razzies into a thing. And I have a long and complicated history with the Razzies. Here's the thing. In my current form, I don't respect them, really.
No.
But I also can't deny that, like, I was kind of big into the Razzies when I was younger. I mean, most especially, like, as a kid, in high school, when I was first getting into, like, bad movies. When I was first getting into, like, funny bad movies, my Bible was the official Razzie movie guide, which is, it's a collection of like 100 movies that John Wilson put out somewhere in the early 2000s, and I could probably look and see exactly when. And I would drag this thing into, like, I took you to Movie Trading Company when you were in Texas. I would drag this thing into the DVD store and just, like, go down the aisles looking for the movies in it. I was, like, dedicated to watching these movies. And I gotta say, as far as, like, a guide for, like, getting into bad movies, there's certainly some good, like, bad movie 101 stuff in there. But I mean, for one thing, like, anything that, like, discusses bad movies, inevitably you run into, like, the fuck you, that's a good movie pick.
Right.
And I think the official Razzie movie guide has more than its fair share of fuck you, that's a good movie picks. I kind of like the Oscar, which is one it calls out. I really like High School Confidential. That's a fun one. He put Beyond Valley of the Dolls in here, and that's the one that I'm most like, okay, fuck you, Beyond Valley of the Dolls is a masterpiece. I love Beyond Valley of the Dolls. Fuck you, that's a great movie. There's also a lot of movies in there that are just fucking boring. There are some really boring picks in that book. There was this, like, Liberace movie. This movie that starred Liberace called, like, Sincerely Yours, I think. I recorded it off of TMC. TMC was showing it. And I recorded it. And I watched it. And was incredibly bored by that. And then years later, I was, like, flipping through my copy of the book again. And I'm like, why do I have a check mark next to Sincerely Yours? What's Sincerely Yours? Oh, that Liberace movie! I forgot that existed! I could not tell you a damn thing that happens in that movie. I have forgotten that movie completely.
Yeah, I guess if I could put my, like, two cents in with the Razzies, I think that, like, a lot of it is, like, a popularity contest now, kind of like the Oscars. Whatever's, like, the popular bad movie, they'll put in, whether it's popular because it's fun or popular because people just hate it.
Yeah, I mean, I've said this before, but it's, like, it's become so ubiquitous and mainstream that it would be more accurate to say this is the most hated movie of the year.
Yeah.
Like, they gave it to the Emoji Movie, which, like, I'm sure the Emoji Movie sucks. Is it really the worst movie of that year, or no. Is it just the most hated movie of that year?
No, I mean, there's Disney and Pixar movies I've seen, like, okay, and there's not Pixar movies I've seen that are worse than it. Just Pixar movies that I believe are probably worse than it. But there's Disney movies I've seen that are worse than the Emoji Movie, you know? It's,
I've never seen the Emoji Movie.
I watched
it. And I refuse, it's one of the few movies I just, like, refuse to watch.
I don't have a lot of those. I do have some, and, like, they're not... And, like, most of them are over something, like, I guess petty. Like, I refuse to watch Ant-Man because they kicked Edgar... They didn't kick Edgar right off. It's just, like, they didn't let him make the movie that he wanted to make. So I'm kind of like, yeah, I'm not going to watch Ant-Man. That's bullshit. Pooh, Blood, and Honey won last for 2024. And, like, I don't...
That's... I don't know. That might be fair.
That's a really bad one. It's funny that it's, like, one that we talked about, too. Although, it's like one of the only modern ones. Like, it's the only time we ever did one that, like, was a movie released the year we talked about it.
Yeah. I think... Yeah, no, I ranked Lady Ballers lower than that when I did my end of the year review. So right. even Pooh, Blood, and Honey was not my absolute last place for that year.
It might have been mine, but I didn't watch as much as you did.
You didn't watch Lady Ballers?
No, I did not.
I even from the start, I feel like the Razzies kind of, I don't know, I feel like early on they had pretty bad taste in terms of, like, making fun of stuff. Because, like, in their first couple years, they nominated Friday the 13th, The Shining, Quirrell, all of these were up for, like, Worst Picture, and I'm like... No, fuck you.
Yeah.
The Shining? Really? Quirrell? What are we doing here?
I gotta say, like, I can't say I dislike the Razzies as much as the Oscars, because I think the Oscars just has way more outrageous shit they've done over the years, but I think that the Oscars have a lot more value than the Razzies, just because at the very fucking least, it can get a director off the ground. Like, it is possible for the Oscars to do good, where if the Razzies... I mean, I have nothing against the idea of the Razzies. It's just an execution. It's like, okay, you're boring like the Oscars, but also nothing good can come from it.
I think I might just hate the Oscars more, because they have, like... all the star power and are yet still somehow completely obnoxious.
Oh yeah. No, it's a horrible show.
And they are, like, unquestionably the more respected institution.
Yeah.
Like, the Razzies is still hashing it out with, like, the Stinker's Bad Movie Awards, which probably is a more respectable institution than the Razzies.
Right. Yeah, it's just, like... I don't know, if you want to talk about bad movies like this, if you want to do a show dedicated to this, I feel like you either got to take the approach of, like, loving bad movies and trying to find ones that are actually, like, worth watching, which I'm not surprised they're not going to do that, or you need to actually try to find, like, what's the worst movie, you know? And I don't think they do either.
Yeah. No, I mean, they completely missed out on Troll 2, The Room, and Birdemic when they came out.
Right.
Even something mainstream, even something Hollywood, like Book of Henry, completely ignored by the Razzies.
Yeah. And all those movies you've mentioned would be ones that I'd be happy to learn about from a award show like that, you know? So I just think it kind of misses its mark in, like, both ways the show could work.
Yeah.
And I've never really had a lot of respect for it, but it's not because it's an award show that focuses on bad movies, because I think you can do that, but the execution is fucking worthless.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's an institution that definitely meant something to me at a certain time in my life, but...
Yeah. And that's...
I am very much past that point in my life.
I guess that's, like, one thing you could say that's good about it, is it does, like, yeah, like, it probably did help you get into, like, your love for bad movies.
Yeah,
then.
I mean...
But, like, it also...
sure.
That's something you can give it some props for sure, but it's... Yeah,
like... I mean, even... It helped me when I was trying to get into bad movies. If you are trying to get into bad movies and you're looking for, like, a good bad movies book, I mean, I assume if you're listening to our podcast, you know your way around bad movies, but just in case, if you're looking for, like, a good getting into bad movies book, I would recommend Edward Scamilla's, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, So Bad It's Good. It literally starts on a whole chapter that's, like, Bad Movies 101, that has, like, Troll 2, The Room, Birdemic, all that good stuff. But also has, like, some good deep cuts in there. That's how I found out about Flyin' Ryan, which is a hilarious movie.
Oh, I love Flyin' Ryan. I think another thing, too, is, like, if the Razzies were even trying to do that, which they're not, you can get, like, better sources on that just from, like, YouTube videos now. You know, just, like...
Yeah, it's absolutely.
It's, like, kind of an obsolete show, but... I don't even know if I can give it, like, the honor of calling it obsolete, because that would imply that it was, like, that it is trying to be, like, a source for that, which it really isn't. It's just kind of, like, point and laugh kind of thing. Like, haha, we agree, these are bad. Everybody else thought these were bad. We also think it's bad.
I mean, fair enough putting the screws to Hollywood, like... Fuck them. They make so much shit. It is worth calling them out for the shit they make.
Sure.
But I don't know that the Razzies is particularly effective at that.
Mm-hmm.
You want to talk about Can't Stop the Music?
Yeah, introduce Can't Stop the Music.
So, Can't Stop the Music is a film very, very, very loosely adapted... from the real-life story of how the Village People were formed?
It says in the description that it's a fictional take, yeah, like, they're not even trying to hide it.
Yeah, I mean, there are minor elements that carry over and we'll get into it, but... Yeah, no, for the most part, this is, like, a completely fictional story of the Village People. It's about Steve Guttenberg... is this composer, he writes music, and he just needs a group to sing this music for him. And his friend in Greenwich Village, he and this woman, like, share an apartment in Greenwich Village, and they collect this, like, assortment of weirdos who can sing and dance well. And gradually they form the Village People, the hot new sound of the 1980s. And it's their adventures, like, coming up as a musical act. That's mostly it. The girl he lives with, he's like their manager. She's like their manager, and she is dating this, like, really boring, uptight lawyer guy. And that's kind of important to what goes on in the movie, but, like, not that much. Michael, what'd you think of Can't Stop the Music?
I think, despite watching a movie about an actual gay couple and watching a movie about the transition in process, this might be the gayest movie we've covered on Hollow Victories. And and just to not give anyone the wrong idea about me, I'm not saying that as a bad thing. In fact, I think when this movie's at its gayest is when it's the most entertaining.
Absolutely.
And I thought it was fun, kind of like Xanadu. It's like whenever they're doing a song, like whenever they're really getting into it, it's entertaining to watch. Like, the sets are cool, the shots are cool, the songs are, you know, catchy. Like you said, it's probably not something I'm going to go and listen to on my own after this, but, I mean, the songs are catchy. Like, it's not a drag to sit through any of that. Yeah. I do think the in-between parts are a lot harder to sit through than Xanadu, and I think the two-hour runtime is partially to blame for that. I also think a lot of these characters are weird. Like, I think Caitlyn Jenner's character... who I didn't even recognize that as Caitlyn Jenner until after, like, looking it up, because I didn't really know what Caitlyn Jenner looked like back then. That character would have been a villain if the movie was made today, because he's just, like, this really insecure lawyer character who gets angry at his girlfriend a lot for, like, wearing outfits that he'd say are too revealing on TV, even though, like, they weren't that revealing honestly. It's just kind of a standard dress in a lot of them. Maybe a little bit of cleavage shown, but nothing crazy. So yeah, I think this character would like literally be the antagonist of the movie if it was made today.
It's weird how much the movie insists upon the heterosexuality of the village people. And even to some degree, Steve Guttenberg, who's supposed to be like the songwriter producer behind the village people, and the actual songwriter producer behind the village people, was very much a gay man.
Mm-hmm. I believe that.
They kind of have it in there because he's like, he's living with this woman, but there's like nothing romantic between them, you know?
Yeah.
Like, like she has a whole relationship with Caitlyn Jenner's character, which is just fucking wild. why were you like, yeah, that person. That's the person who should play this guy. Like, here's the thing. I love the village people's story. The village people have one of the most fascinating stories to me. If I could make a biopic about, like, any famous person from the last 100 years, I'd make a Village People movie, because it was this, like, gay songwriter-producer and this one singer got together and made an album. It was mostly this one singer. It's the cop. The cop in the group is the one main singer who started on the first album. They had some session musicians come in, sing backup, and all that. But it was mostly just him on the first album.
Mm-hmm.
But then, like, the first album takes off and people want to book the Village People. And you can't be the Village People if you're just one guy. So this producer goes to this costume party at a gay bar and sees this bartender in Native American garb dancing around on the bar serving people drinks. And, you know, everyone loves him. And sitting there, he came up with this, like, whole concept for the village people where they would all be these, like, masculine archetypes, you know, the leather man, the cop, the construction worker, the cowboy, and the Native American. And the movie kind of reflects this, but they don't set that scene at a gay bar. They set it at a normal disco bar, and it's just, it's so weird to see him, like, up dancing around in this setting, because it's like, that's not really the place you would do that. Now, if this were a gay bar, sure, that checks out. It doesn't make as much sense when it's, like, a normal heterosexual bar, you know?
Yeah.
And of course, like, famously, a lot of their music from that time was, like, gay coded, but like with that thin veil of like plausible deniability,
right?
So they could be like, no, we're not gay,
right?
But very much they were gay. I mean, some of the village people were straight, but the music was gay. The music was written by a gay man about gay things, you right? Know?
I mean, you can't watch YMCA and deny that, like, it's.
In this film, absolutely not. Like, we talked about Sheena the Jungle Queen, the PG movie with the most female nudity I've ever seen. Well, Can't Stop the Music is the PG movie with the most male nudity I've ever seen. There are straight up dicks in that scene.
Yeah.
Although, weirdly, on the topic of, like, the village people's music, YMCA is the only, like, big song of theirs they do.
Yeah.
Macho Man is absent from the movie. Go West is absent from the movie. In the Navy is absent from the movie. I almost wonder if there was, like, a rights thing. Like, obviously you can't do a village people movie without YMCA. You gotta do that one. But, yeah. Like, I almost wonder if they just weren't willing to put up for the other, like, big hits.
Yeah.
Crazy scene, though, the YMCA scene.
Yeah, it was fun. I thought the milkshake scene was fun.
Like, I mean, most of their big musical numbers, like you said, most of their big musical numbers are a lot of fun in this.
I think the only one that I wasn't that into is literally, like, the first one where he's, like, roller skating down the highway. And I think, I almost feel like that could have been fun, but they almost ruin it with the effect they're trying to do. Where it's like you're seeing, like, three different shots at once, although two of them are the same shot but mirrored. They do a lot of that in that opening. I was like, I think that they thought that that was a cooler concept than it actually was. I actually think it'd be cooler to just show him doing his thing on the road without half of the screen being cut off.
He just fucking roller skates into this parade.
Yeah.
And no one stops him. He's roller skating into the middle of a big parade.
But I thought that was a very weak way to open the movie. And I get what they were trying to do to, like, make it stand out. But it just, I don't know, I don't think, like, cropping the screen up like that is that interesting of a visual. And that was, like, that's what they had going for them in that opening scene. That was, like, that was the concept. That was the idea.
I mean, I didn't realize this till we were watching it, but one thing these two movies have in common, both about aspiring artists.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I think they have, like, similar stories. Definitely different executions, but
I kind of think, like, I almost do respect this more as a movie, because I feel like there are funny moments in this movie that are, like, deliberately funny. Like, there are a lot of deliberate laughs I got out of this movie. It wasn't all just, like, pointing and laughing at it for being, like, hilariously lame. Like, there were jokes I thought were good.
Yeah. I liked the guy on the phone, when he would just enter an office and immediately start picking them up. Like, he had a good delivery of it too. I feel like they could have played the campiness up of that, honestly. Like, imagine a scene where they're in a building that, like, isn't even his and he's still answering the fucking phones, you know? Like, the joke becomes stagnant at a point, but, like, I thought initially it was funny.
Yeah. Stuff like that.
Yeah, it definitely, you know, despite being 2 hours long, it wasn't miserable to sit through. I wouldn't go as far as to say, I definitely think an hour and 30 minutes is more appropriate for a movie like this, but
it could definitely have been shorter, but I agree. I don't feel like it ever wasted my time.
Yeah. And it also, like, kept the musical segments coming in. Like, there was never a point where we went, like, 20 minutes without one.
Yeah. I will say, in spite of that, like, the movie, in spite of how long it is, the movie kind of ends without much conclusion.
Kind of, yeah. Like,
they go to San Francisco for this big, like, musical concert party they're putting on. They perform the title track, and then, like, that's the end of the movie.
Yeah, like, it kind of feels like there should have been a scene after that of, like, oh, yeah, you're actually a big hit now. Whoa, like, someone's on the phone. We're going off the charts. It's the 80s. But they didn't have that. They didn't have any of that good stuff.
It is funny when they like, keep insisting that the Village People are going to be, like, the big sound of the 80s.
Yeah. that's why I keep doing that bit. And that's not even that's far from the only movie to do that, but there's a lot of, like, 80s movies where they talk about, like, this is gonna be big, it's the 80s. I do think that Xanadu did better with I think they had more variety in their ideas for scenes. Like, I think a lot of the Can't Stop the Music musical numbers are fairly similar to one another. Like, you know, there's no crazy, it's animated for a scene. There's no, oh, here's a song where everybody has, like, this outline around them. I still think that the going to buy a suit song out crazies anything in this movie.
They had a scene where they had, like, weird outlines at, like, the very beginning at the dance club. And when Steve Guttenberg gets his big break as a DJ.
You're right. They have a lot of fucking interesting angles in that one, actually. The Indian guy especially has, like, a lot of I don't know how to explain it. They do they messed up the color a lot in that scene too.
Yeah,
they kind of, like, intentionally oversaturated, like, shots. I don't know a lot about the Village People, but it did start to, like, click with me as I watched, you know. Like, I was like, I remembered the name afterwards. I was like, oh yeah, I know this band, I know this group. I'm very well aware of this group. I just didn't know going into the movie Can't Stop the Music was about them. I had no reference to what this movie was.
I will say, despite the title being a reference to a Village People song, I constantly get it mixed up with that Rihanna song that's like, please don't stop the music.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what goes through my head when I hear Can't Stop the Music, not the Village People song.
You want to get on casting? Or is there something else you want to talk about first?
No, let's talk about cast.
Casting. Steve Guttenberg as Jack Morrell. I don't know, he's fine. He has like kind of this chipper attitude. He's a nice boy. You want to see him succeed. I actually liked him more than the other guy. What was his name again? Michael what?
Michael Beck.
Yeah, I liked him more than Michael Beck in terms of like the inspiring artist. He just seemed like such a enthusiastic person. Michael Beck honestly probably spends too much of the movie bitching. Well, this guy is just full of enthusiasm. I liked him.
Yeah, I mean, Steve Guttenberg, he's a funny guy, even in, like, some pretty bad movies. I don't think he's given, like, enough material to work with in this. And to be fair, this was probably, like, a little before he got popular.
Yeah.
As a comedian, so they were probably, like, a little more strict about, like, making him follow the script and not just letting him riff.
Yeah.
But, like, even some of, like, the worse Police Academy movies, they just let him riff and he's kind of funny in them.
Nice.
Another Community alumni, he was in the episode where they make a movie. He's like, the producer who comes in and is like, if you have a movie that stars the ham girl guy, We can sell it.
He was funny in that episode. I love how invested he is in Glip Glop. I like, honest to God, the movie makes it kind of feel like it's going to be his movie, but we definitely, as it goes on, get more focus on the lawyer and girl character.
Yeah.
So he definitely takes a backseat about, like, I'd say, like, after, like, the first act, he's kind of not the focus anymore.
Yeah.
And I honestly like those two characters less, so I would have been fine with it staying on him.
Yeah.
I think Caitlyn Jenner's character is confusing. Go ahead.
Yeah, Caitlyn Jenner's character is just kind of boring. But I mean, the joke is that she's like this boring lawyer character.
I mean, I feel like they could have done something when he kind of comes back the next day and admits he was being a jerk and admits someone who's kind of out of his element but is genuinely trying to help these guys. I think you could make something interesting with that. I even think it could like work really well if the other characters were even more animated during the scenes where they were just talking, you know, where he's almost like the straight man of like quite literally the straight man of the group. You could have fun with that. You could have fun with this character who, like, almost doesn't belong with this group, but he's helpful to them, so he's, like, welcomed there. The movie kind of, like, chooses to focus on him, and I think it focuses on Valerie's Samantha more, but...
Yeah, and I like her well enough. I don't know why you would choose, like, a former Olympic champion to be like the main lawyer guy in your movie.
Yeah, I don't know. But I don't know, it's just I don't know, those two like are not the more interesting parts of it. I agree that like Samantha is fine, like it's not like a terrible character or anything. I think a movie focused more on Jack and like the Village People could have been, I mean, that should be what the movie's about, right?
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing, like, based on my knowledge of other movies that focus on bands and just, like, kind of going off their performances in this, I feel like the Village People are maybe not the best actors. They definitely, they give the most lines to Felipe Rose, the Native American, mm-hmm. And he's definitely the most charismatic one of the group. He's definitely the one who, like... He has the presence to be in a movie. The rest of them are kind of...
Like, it's mainly the costumes that give them that movie presence.
But, yeah, but I mean, like, they don't have to do a whole lot in this movie. They just kind of show up and sing.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know.
This was, weirdly enough, like, we were just talking about Olivia Newton-John in Grease. This was written by the two guys who wrote Grease.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I mean, it's apart from Grease, this is the only other movie they have written.
Really?
Yes.
That's actually crazy.
Alan Carr and Bronette Woodard.
Huh.
Bronte Woodard. It's directed by a woman, Nancy Walker. Woo! Her only directorial credit.
Woo!
Is this the second movie we've talked about with a female director?
I feel like there's been more than that. Has there not been?
No, Love on a Leash was also directed by a... Okay, third, yeah. At least.
Well, Tank Girl was directed by a woman. Is that the other one you were talking about?
Tank Girl was the first one.
Okay. Love on a Leash. I don't know. I feel like we could probably find something else.
Maybe.
I know Barbed Wire maybe wasn't this... directed by a woman, but...
No. Tank Girl and Love on a Leash, at the very least, are two that have been directed by... So this is at least the third movie we've talked about directed by a woman.
Yeah, I mean...
Out of 76.
At the very least, their movies are, like, higher on my list. So there's that.
No, I mean, Love on a Leash, Tank Girl, Can't Stop the Music. These are, like, all some of the best movies we've talked about.
Yeah. I've honestly got Can't Stop the Music, like, more towards the middle, but closer to the top. Like, there's a lot above it where Love on a Leash and Tank Girl are way higher up. Because I do genuinely enjoy those. And this one, I mean, I enjoy a lot of it, but it's... I wouldn't watch it again. Like, Xanadu, I could show someone this one. There's too much. There's too much that I don't want to see again.
Yeah, it's been a while since I've seen either of these movies. I definitely watched both in high school. I remembered a lot more of Xanadu than this one. And like, on a rewatch, I'm kind of like, yeah, I see why that is.
Yeah. Anyone else in the cast worth talking about? I mean, Paul Sand is like kind of that, they talked about him or already the guy on the phones, like the manager character. He can be funny, but it's another, his character just kind of fucks off too. It almost feels like there's like this big, another, like, it's part of a love triangle, except I guess not even really a love triangle, because you know that Samantha's character isn't even, like, remotely interested.
Yeah.
So, like, it's not, like, he's not a real candidate, but he's another character who just kind of fucks off at a point. Near the end, granted, but, like, I don't know, this movie didn't want to wrap everything up, I guess.
June Havoc, who plays Steve Guttenberg's mother. I thought she was pretty fun.
I liked her.
I like the scene where, like, Steve, the record producer, is, like, waiting for, you know, the female lead to get on the plane with him, and then it's Steve Guttenberg and his mom.
Yeah. It's a likable thing, too, where she's, like, overly, like, kind of like an overly supportive mother up to the point where it's, like, embarrassing, but she's still, like, at the very least, she's also, like, one, it's nice that it's supportive, but also she's, like, getting shit done for them.
Yeah, and I like that she, like, brings all this food, and, like, that's kind of what wins him over.
Yeah.
And here's the thing, I was literally about to say, like, the joke is Steve Guttenberg is Jewish, and then he's like, oh, she's not even Jewish, my dad was Jewish. And I'm like, oh, okay. They beat me to the punch on that one, I guess. Honestly, Xanadu did that too, because after Olivia Newton-John says she's a muse, I was about to make a joke about, like, oh, well, at least she's enjoying this, and then, like, they make that joke in the movie, and I'm like, ah, wow, both of these movies joke sniped me. Yeah, I mean, Can't Stop the Music, it's fun. It's a fun enough movie. I wish we got an honest biopic about the village people, but...
Maybe we could now, because I wouldn't have to, like, hide the fact... Try to, like... Like you said, like, they kind of made it, like, as heterosexual as they could.
Yeah, now you could totally get away with it. In 1980, it would have been pretty bold to do that.
Yeah. And I mean, if that's what they had to do to get the movie made, then maybe it's, like, worth it for that. Just, I mean, someone might even argue the exact opposite, but, and I'd understand that, but it's kind of like people, I don't know, if you really want to make a Village People movie and you have to work through the compromises, they still got those music videos in there. They still got to be as flashy with those as they wanted to be. Like, it accomplished
something. They still sucked some dicks in this movie.
They still had some dicks in the movie, yeah. And they don't, like, ever flat out say that all the members of the Village People are straight, dude. I don't think there's ever, like, I just don't think they say they're gay either, you know?
Yeah, I mean, they do leave, like, them and Steve Guttenberg kind of ambiguous, but they also all have, like, dance numbers with women.
Yeah,
with
that's
maybe
true.
Maybe the exception of Steve Guttenberg's character. But even then, like, I'm sorry, Steve Guttenberg is just, like, so straight. I'm like, yeah, no, this is, like, heterosexual casting for this character. If they had put, like, a gayer actor in that role, I could kind of be like, oh, they were trying to represent the actual producer for the Village People who was actually gay. Because, you know, he refuses to have a relationship with this woman that he lives with, apparently. But, like, I don't know, Steve Guttenberg, I don't really buy it.
Do we know how the band and the person that Guttenberg was playing, like the person writing the music, do we know how they felt about this movie?
No, as far as I'm aware, no one from the band has commented on the movie.
Okay. I mean, silence can be an indication of a lot, but...
Sure, I mean, I'm sure the Village People don't really get asked about this one this much. Like, it definitely came out while they were on the decline in popularity. And for the most part, I think it's fallen through the cracks.
Uh-huh.
Apart from its, like, notoriety amongst, like, the Razzie crowd.
Right.
Well, I think we've made it to the portion of the evening where we got a vote on this.
Yeah.
And, man, this is kind of a tough one for me. I enjoyed Xanadu more, but I almost feel like Can't Stop the Music is, like, a better put-together film. But it's really close for me. I'm not sure. God. I mean, I like both of them well enough. I don't know. You vote first.
I am doing Xanadu, but I do agree it's close, and I don't think it's outrageous to vote for Can't Stop the Music. I could imagine a lot of people preferring it, honestly. Like, I could see a lot of people preferring the music in Can't Stop the Music. I could see a lot of people preferring the, like, music video, essentially music videos, and Can't Stop the Music. I think Xanadu gets the lead for me just because I feel like it's more condensed. Like, I think it stays to a more appropriate screen time, like a runtime for the movie. And I just enjoyed it more. I could watch Xanadu again. Can't Stop the Music, I don't think I would watch it again. But I do agree it's close. I don't think it's outrageous to vote for the other one. If you in the audience are against me on this one, I fully accept that.
No, I'm voting Can't Stop the Music. And I'm gonna be against you and the audience on this one again.
Damn.
Because the audience is overwhelmingly for Xanadu. It's 82% for Xanadu.
Damn!
18% Can't Stop the Music.
Ah, man, I'm surprised by
that.
No,
it's not close at all.
It would be close.
I kind of get it. I feel like if you haven't seen these two movies for a while, you might be like, well, Xanadu, it's fun, it's wild, it's campy, it sticks in the mind. Where Can't Stop the Music, not so much. But I feel like Can't Stop the Music has, like, moments where it is genuinely funny, where it's, like, trying to be funny and it succeeds. Uh-huh. Where Xanadu, I don't think is really trying that hard to be funny, and yet it is very funny throughout. It's certainly the more entertaining movie. It's certainly the movie I would rewatch faster. But I think I gotta give Can't Stop the Music the edge. It feels more like a real movie, I guess.
Yeah.
Xanadu wins. And I'm fine with that. Sometimes I'll name alternative pair-ups we could have done. I think Xanadu versus the Apple could have been fun. I really like the Apple. I'm not sure if I like the Apple ironically or unironically, but it's a fun movie. It's, I mean, a lot like Xanadu. It's just like this really campy musical. Fun movie. I enjoy the Apple. The Apple might have won. The Apple might have won, actually. Next time on Hollow Victories, I mean, today we discussed an institution that was important to me in my younger years, the Razzies. But next time we're going to be talking about an institution that was far more important to me as a child, and you as well, I'm aware, Pixar Animation Studios.
Ooh.
A company who has two franchises with more than one sequel, and both of those franchises, as it happens, have spin-off movies. Granted, one of those Pixar had the foresight to go, Disney, if you want that, you gotta make it yourself. The other, unfortunately, is officially a Pixar movie. It's Planes versus Lightyear.
I literally messaged you, like, less than a week ago, saying the only way I'm watching Lightyear is if you pick it for Hollow Victories.
No, we were, like, just the other day, Michael and I were messaging about, like, doing a Pixar Hollow Victories, and I'm, like trying to hold myself together, like, oh, I was already gonna do Pixar next time, Michael. I was already gonna do this.
All right, I mean, that's it. That'll be interesting. Is this the first Pixar movie? We've done Disney, yes, with Ralph Breaks the Internet, but we haven't done Pixar yet. I mean, to be fair, most Pixar movies are good, so, like, that's not like they'll be showing up here a lot, but there's, like, probably, like, three or four movies from that studio.
Yeah,
that
we, I mean, what we were specifically talking about was either, like, Cars 2 versus Cars 3, or, like, Cars 2 versus The Good Dinosaur.
Yeah.
Like, the generally accepted, like, worst of Pixar. But I had already planned on doing, like, the spin-off Pixar movies.
Cars 3 wasn't even that poorly received.
I hated it. It's I'm rewatching my way through the Pixar movies now, and I haven't gotten to that one just yet. But from my memory, it is the worst Pixar movie. It's at least on the first viewing the Pixar movie that I hated the most.
Right. I think that it's I think that you're killing two birds with one stone here, because you're working on something.
I am.
I'll leave It'll it be fun. That. Yeah. All right. Looking forward to it. I mean, I definitely could talk about those.
I also want to do an Out of the Ring on Buzz Lightyear of Star Command.
Oh yeah, there was a movie
just
before.
To like just so we can like review the old version of the Buzz Lightyear spinoff and be like, wow, this is so much better than Lightyear. I also still want to do an Out of the Ring on Batman 89 if we find the time. That has kind of been put off for a while. But we'll do Buzz Lightyear Star Command for Out of the Ring. And until next time?
Till next time.
For my co-host, Michael Shadackle, I am Matt Presents. We'll see you in the next one.
Peace.